objective of this experiment is to determine the specific heat of combustion of granola. Granola is a heterogeneous mixture. It's primarily composed of carbohydrates. So when it burns, it generates predominantly carbon dioxide and water, plus any other minor oxides associated with the other elements that it contains, plus any inert compounds that do not combust. The way to determine the heat of combustion of granola is through bomb calorimetry. The idea is that we have an isolated, thermally isolated system within which we have a water bath, 2 liters of water, within which we submerge the so-called bomb. The bomb is a sealed vessel capable of holding up to and more than 30 atmospheres. We will charge the bomb with 30 atmospheres of oxygen, and we will place the sample of granola therein. The granola sample will be exposed to a nichrome wire, which we thread to 2 ignition leads. When we close the circuit, the nichrome wire heats up and sparks the combustion of granola. The mass of heat that is generated largely will get sunk into the 2 liters of water, and we will observe the rise in temperature of the water bath. The total heat, therefore, is given by the specific heat of our sample times its mass, plus 2 other heat sources. The nichrome wire, which is going to be 10 centimeters when we thread it, will burn, and for every centimeter, it generates 9.6 joules. So based on the initial length and the final length, we can determine how much heat is generated by the nichrome wire. The second source, Q2, is due to any gases, primarily nitrogen, that are within the bomb calorimeter. We have a procedure, however, for charging the bomb calorimeter with oxygen, whereby we charge it and we bleed out the oxygen, and in doing so, bleed out most of the residual air, and then we recharge again. So for all intents and purposes, the heat generated by any residual nitrogen in the bomb will be zero. The total heat generated is proportional to this rise in temperature, and the constant of proportionality is the heat capacity of the calorimeter. The heat capacity of the calorimeter is a lumped heat capacity. It includes the 2 liters of water, the bomb, and any reactants that are not consumed. So since we have exactly 2 liters of water, and accounting for 2 liters of water, of course, would give us since there's 4.18 joules per gram of water, the heat capacity is going to be in the neighborhood of 10,000 joules. But this is something that has to be determined. So in the course of the experiment, the first trial is going to be with benzoic acid, which has a known heat of combustion. And since we know the heat of combustion, we can determine the total heat. We will know Q1, Qm, and the mass. And from the total heat and the observed delta T, we can calculate the heat capacity of the bomb calorimeter, Q total divided by delta T. And then in trials 2 and 3, and you don't necessarily have to do it in this order, that will be dedicated to granola. The idea there is you will be able to calculate Q1, the heat generated from the nichrome wire. Based on the delta T and knowing your heat capacity, you can determine Q total, and from Q total, you can determine, let me write this like this, you can determine the total heat generated, And from Q1, you can determine Q sub M, and that's the objective. For the virtual section, I will do an additional trial. Trial 4 is for the virtual lab, and that too will be benzoic acid. The idea is that with two trials of benzoic acid, if you have that additional time, which the virtual section does because they're just watching a video of me actually doing the experiment, the idea is that with two trials of benzoic acid, you could come up with an average heat capacity of the calorimeter, and based on that average, you will be able to average both the trials 2 and 3 to come up with the average heat of combustion of granola. For those doing the lab in attendance in person, this trial 1 alone is sufficient to give you the heat capacity, and from that heat capacity, those two trials, you'll get two respective heats of combustion, which you'll average, and then you will compare to the nutritional label, where I believe it's something like, it's on the label. This is the bomb calorimeter. It comes with a digital thermometer and an ignition box. The calorimeter itself is essentially surrounded by this outer insulating jacket. On the top, we have a detachable cover, which contains a propeller shaft, which we can connect to a drive motor by way of an elastic band. These are two ignition connections, more about that. And these are the ignition probes that connect to the bomb within. We pull out the bucket, and within the bucket, we have the bomb itself. This is the bomb. So the first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to fill my bucket with water. We're going to need 200 milliliters of water, and I have a graduated cylinder expressly for that purpose. 2 liters of water. So using a micro pipette, I'm just going to pull off the remaining water, the excess water. And at that point, I'm good. I'm going to go ahead and I'm going to fill the jacket, the bucket, I should say. For the time being, I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to take my bucket, and I am going to place it and when I have fully charged my bomb, I'm going to place it within, and we'll pick up here where we left off. So let's talk about the bomb itself. The assembly of this is very similar to a mason jar. We have a collar, it's threaded, and then we have a cap or a top, and we're going to pull out this top, and within, and I'm going to put this right here, so the topmost, we have this O-ring, which serves as a seal. We have two connections for our ignition. We have a release valve, and then we have an intake valve for the oxygen. The sample itself will go into this crucible, and then we'll go ahead and we'll thread it, we'll assemble it, we'll load it, we'll put it under the water, and we'll connect the bomb calorimeter, and then we'll start the first trial. For the first trial, I'm going to use benzoic acid. This will be to calibrate the bomb calorimeter. It has a given heat of combustion,
of 26.454 megajoules per kilogram. And these pellets are pre-made, and they're approximately a gram. So next, now that I have my sample, I'm going to put my sample of benzoic acid into this little receptacle. Notice I'm not using gloves at this point. The reason being is that I find that when it comes to connecting the wire, the gloves tend to get in the way, and I need all the nimbleness in my fingers that I can get. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take some of the nichrome wire, and if I cut this from kink to kink, the way it's spooled, I will get 10 centimeters. So I'm going to cut the nichrome wire from kink to kink. Let's see if I already have a piece here. I'm going to verify that it's I'm going to measure that it is in fact 10 centimeters. It should be 10 centimeters, but to the nearest tenth of the centimeter, I will record its length. And this is just a little bit longer than 10.3 centimeters. Okay. So now I'm ready to thread the needles on the ignition leads. So there are these little holes. So what I will first do is I pass the wire through one, and I give myself about a centimeter or so, which I then wrap around. And because I'm sure that I have a little bit of extra to play with, I'm going to give it another wrap, and then I'm going to push down this little aglet that seals the contact. And then I'm going to connect the other. I just want to verify that I can get this to touch, which I can. That gives me some idea of how much slack I have, so I should have enough. Now I'm going to connect the other. So if you can see here, what I've done is I've connected both leads. I have a secure connection, and then I put enough bent into the wire such that it's going to touch my sample. And that's all I need to do, and that looks pretty firm and good. Okay, so now I'm gonna go ahead and I'm gonna assemble the bomb. I carefully take this off, load it, and open up this release valve, give myself a bit of room here. And now I'm going to put the collar on. And what I really want to be observant of is that I've closed it all the way. So as I screw this down and close this, what I want to look for, what I want to look at are the threads that are exposed. And I will know that I have completely closed this when there are no threads exposed. So there I'm getting the sense of metal on metal. And there I've reached the end. I'm going to back off a bit, just loosen it, and then I'm gonna slowly, just gingerly bring it into a close. And I verify that there are no threads exposed, hence I know that it is completely closed. Really wanna emphasize this because there is a tendency for that O-ring to, with time, to get a little slack. And it will provide some resistance as you screw the top down. And you may think you have it closed when in fact you do not. The telltale again will be visible threads. In this case, we have no visible threads. If you proceed to run this experiment with the collar not completely tied down, that is to say with threads exposed, you run the risk of exposing that O-ring to the combustion within. And what can then happen is that O-ring can actually wind up burning, thereby breaching the seal, thereby allowing 30 atmospheres of high temperature gas to escape. And what will wind up happening, if that does happen, and it has occurred before, is the top of the calorimeter will blow off. It's happened twice, once in this lab, once in Dr. Whitten's. So there is danger in this lab. There are precautions we can take, however. So we just want to emphasize those. But now that this is assembled, I'm ready to charge it. So I'm going to go ahead and carry it with two hands, providing some support, and then carry it over to charge it with oxygen. So I draw your attention to the intake valve, which is this cylinder, which basically has an orifice, and it's a one-way orifice. And I'm going to connect this brass fitting to it. And the way you want to connect it is with sort of the arm of it up. And this slips on right there. So a couple things to point out. If I open this up, I can hear air, oxygen escaping at this valve, this exit valve. If I close this, I'm now filling the cylinder, but I can hear oxygen escaping. So I'm going to close the release valve. And I see the oxygen rising up to 30 atmospheres. And I'm going to go ahead and close this. And now what I'm going to do is open my release valve to purge it of this oxygen. And in doing so, I will purge it of the residual air, and importantly, the residual nitrogen that is still contained within. So I'm going to gently open this, purge. Watching the pressure drop. Okay, so I've purged it, so now I'm going to go ahead, and this time I'm going to load it for real. Go up to 30 atmospheres, and so filling it up again, stop it at 30 atmospheres. It is now fully loaded with 30 atmospheres since I've purged the majority of the air out. Within reason, we have a pure oxygen environment. We'll take it to be a pure oxygen environment of 30 atmospheres. I now want to disconnect my line. In order to do that, I need to release the pressure in the line. So I'll go ahead and do it here. And now I can pull the fitting off. And I'm ready to now assemble the bomb calorimeter. The first thing I'm going to do is I'm going to put the bomb under the water. And if we have a tight seal, what we should see are no bubbles emanating from the bomb underwater. And as I look, I might see a couple bubbles first emerge. That's natural. But I see nothing emerging from these holes. If I agitate, it looks like there was some entrained air or air, most likely there. But looking at it, no bubbles are emerging. So that's a sign that I have a solid seal. So I will not run the risk of having a breach. So the next thing, I'm going to connect the ignition leads. And the polarity of these do not matter. So I connect them underwater. Next, I am going to put the top on, and there is space for the stir. I'm going to connect the propeller shaft to the drive shaft. I'm going to go ahead and plug the motor in, and I'm going to begin stirring. And so this will establish a thermal equilibrium bath. The temperature is something I wish to monitor. Next, I'm going to connect the ignition wires to the ignition box. The polarity doesn't matter. So one to common, and the other to the other to 7 centimeters. So you notice I have not connected this in. The reason being is I want to demonstrate what the procedure is for igniting the bomb. I'm going to press this button and this red light will immediately go on and then it'll immediately go off. The red light signals that we have a circuit. The minute that nichrome wire burns up, we no longer have a circuit, so we can let go. But before I ignite, I want to take about 2 minutes, and I've already gone beyond the 2 minutes I need for thermal equilibrium, but nonetheless I want to take 2 minutes worth of temperature recordings every 30 seconds before I ignite. Okay, so now we're about to come up to the 2 minute mark, and at 2 minutes, I will ignite. This light will go on and will be off. And the way I know that I have a fire is within the first minute or so, I should see the temperature begin to rise. So I have 1.77 degrees centigrade, 0.783, 0.98, 0.201, 0.237, 0.421. 24.421 at the 2.5 minute mark, we have a fire. We're off and running. We will now record every 30 seconds for approximately around 10 minutes, at which point the temperature will level off and then we'll disassemble. So I've just reached the 10-minute mark, and it appears that my temperature is stabilizing. The last three readings were 26.799 degrees centigrade, 26.799 degrees centigrade, 26.800 degrees centigrade. And as we approach the 10.5-minute mark, 2 minutes being the point of ignition, the temperature is 26.798. So at this point, my temperature has plateaued. The experiment has run its course, and we can begin to turn everything off, disassemble. I will take one last reading at the 11-minute mark and proceed to do that. So, to disassemble, turn the motor off. Unhook the propeller shaft. I'm going to go ahead and disconnect the leads. And at this point, I can pull the bomb out. And notice in pulling the bomb out, I'm pulling water out with it. So I'm going to dump this water in the bucket. And I'll wind up replacing it. The reason why you want to replace your water with each trial is because if you, with successive trials, remove water, your heat capacity of the calorimeter will no longer be correct for subsequent trials if you're using your first trials. So now I've removed my bomb. I want to release the pressure. If I try to open it, I won't because it's still under pressure. These things are foolproof. Notice I can't even turn. pressure released, I should be able to, like a charm, it just comes right off. Okay, voila, nothing is left in the crucible. I do want to look at what remains of the ignition wire. And that's gonna, and I'm gonna try to estimate to the best I can how much wire is left. That will be the final length of that nichrome wire. It looks to be maybe about a centimeter, no more. What is inside the bomb? Nothing but water vapor. It's like Al Capone's vault. Everything incinerated. And all that is left is water, carbon dioxide, and various other oxides. For my next trial, I'm going to do the actual sample of granola. So we have here some Nature Valley granola. According to the label, 190 kilocalories for 42 grams. So that gives you the claimed heat of combustion. What I want is about a gram of this, anywhere between 0.9 to 1.1 grams. So I want to kind of weigh out some kibble somewhere in that range. And then I'm going to take that kibble and I'm going to compress it. I'm going to compress it into a pellet. So I have about 1.1205. That, with what I might lose in making it, that should be good. Okay, so now I want to make my pellets. What I want to do is I'm going to load my sample in here on this sort of beveled side, fitting it into this reservoir side, and then I'm going to use the press to actually compress this granola sample, this kibble, into a pellet. And then when I want to remove the pellet, I simply reverse everything. I will now use this well to receive the pellet and then flip this around and then use the rod to punch out the pellet. So I'm loading it up, trying to get about as much as I can. It's very loose. I'm gonna, like I said, the pressure will compress this. I'm shooting for 1 gram. So I go ahead and compress it. Putting pressure on it, and it doesn't take too much. And so again, little detail, I've compressed it, and now I'm going to, you can see the granola pellet. I'm now going to flip this around, and then use the rod to punch it out. And voila, it just pops out. So there we see the pellet. So now I want to take the mass of this pellet. I have a rough idea, but it's the pellet itself that will get burned up, not the pellet or the kibble. And I have a granola pellet that is 1.0228 grams. So now, for this trial, pretty much it all follows what was previously illustrated with the benzoic acid trial. I'm going to take my pellet. I'm going to put it in that little crucible. I'm going to wire up my the nichrome wire. I'm going to assemble the bomb. I'm going to load the bomb. I'm going to put the bomb in 2 liters of water in the bucket, assemble the calorimeter, go through the exact same steps. So there's nothing more to illustrate. After I do this trial, I'm going to do another trial of granola, another 1 gram pellet. Making the pellet is the same. And for those of you who are doing this lab virtually, I'm going to do an additional trial of the benzoic acid. The reason being is that the benzoic acid, of course, gives us the heat capacity of the calorimeter. And since we're using 2 trials of our sample, and we're going to average those trials to determine the heat of combustion, I think it's fitting to have an average heat capacity to do more than 1 trial of benzoic acid. So the benzoic acid, from those data, from the known heat of combustion of benzoic acid, you can determine the heat capacity of the calorimeter. Based on the heat capacity of the calorimeter, you can determine the total heat that evolves when we combust the sampled granola based on the change.